welcome you tonight to our revival services. What we've been blessed, God has shown up, and we have been blessed by Brother Dwight and Brother Malcolm each and every time that we've met together. And what an honor it is to have you with us tonight. Many of you are guests with us tonight. We want to just say welcome, and we thank you for choosing to be a part of this service and this day. What a wonderful day it's been, even if it's been a little cold. Did anybody get cold today? No? No? Is it winter or spring? Who knows? Guess what? God knows, and that's all that matters, right? That's all that matters. I tell you what, let's pray together, and then after I pray, I want you to turn. I want you to greet one another and welcome each other to being here tonight. Father God, we come before you, seeking your presence, seeking a word from you. God, I pray that you would speak clearly, just as you have in previous times that we've gathered. Speak through the music, speak through the fellowship, speak through the word proclaimed tonight. We thank you for these two men, these servants of yours, Father, who are serving you in our church. And I thank you for this group of people that you've put together tonight to come to lift your name, to worship you. And God, we gather in the name of Jesus, and it's his name that we pray. Amen. Greet one another in Jesus' name.
As you're finding your way back to your seat, turn to hymn number 492. Let's sing the first, second, and last verses of At Calvary. saying, years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the grace that drew salvation's plan, oh, the grace that brought it down to man, oh, the mighty love that God did span on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Sing that chorus again. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Hymn number 500, saved. I found a friend who is all to me. His love is ever true. I love to tell how he lifted me and what his grace can do for me. Saved by his power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete. Saved. Go to the last verse. When poor and needy and all alone, in love he said to me, come unto me and I'll give you power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved. Hymn number 503, and we'll do all three verses. Since Jesus came into my heart, change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul, which was long I had sought, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart. Flood floods of joy, oh my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart, I have ceased from my wandering and going astray. Since Jesus came into my heart, and the sins which were many are all washed away. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart, I shall go there to dwell in that city I know. Since Jesus came into my heart, and I'm happy, so happy, onward I go. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy, oh my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. For our offertory hymn 791, let's do the first, second, and last verses of Jesus. We just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you. Thank you for being so good. Jesus, we just want to praise you. Jesus, we just want to praise you. Jesus, we just want to praise you. Praise you for being so good. Jesus, we know you are coming. Jesus, we know you are coming. Jesus, we know you are coming. Take us to live in your home. I've been working all week to try to get Linda to sing with me, and she begrudgingly agreed to. So, come on.
Amen. Thank you, Miss Linda, for helping us tonight. That's a blessing, Brother Dwight. Thank you so much. What a great song. I'm read today in my quiet time, 1 Timothy. The Apostle Paul said, "This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." He didn't say, "I was, I used to be." He was an old man of God when he said that. In fact, that's the last of his ministry. He was nearing the very end of his journey. And here's an old seasoned soldier of the cross who said, "I realize more now than ever I need a Savior. Thank God Jesus came to save sinners." You have your Bible tonight. I'm going to give you a bit of a challenge. I want you to find the book of the Song of Solomon. Can you find that? The Song of Solomon. If you hit Proverbs, go right. And if you hit Isaiah, go left. Right after the little book of Ecclesiastes, just before the great prophecy of Isaiah, the Song of Solomon. And if you need to look in the index to find the page number, don't be embarrassed. Just so long as you get there, that's what matters. The first rule of going to church is you don't believe anything a preacher says unless you can prove it out of the Bible. It's what the Word of God says that matters tonight, not what some man says it says. What does the Word of God say? So I'd love for you to be with me on the same page as I'm reading together with you tonight the Scriptures, and I'm going to comment on some of the verses, some of the statements made in one of the verses that we're going to read. We'll start reading in verse 1, Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 1. And I'm going to read down to verse 4, and then I'll confine my remarks to half of verse 4. The Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 1. Like the sound of turning pages, don't you, in the house of the Lord? I really do. We ought to be conversing in the Scriptures and do the best we can to find the text when the preacher preaches on them. Of course, we ought to do a whole lot more than that with the Bible. We ought to be in the Word of God personally, privately, outside the church house. But certainly we ought to be following along with the preacher as he's reading the text, because we want to be able to put our finger on, "Thus saith the Lord," right? All right, let's pray before we start reading. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I come to you now to ask something that we have no right to demand of you, but we just ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would take the printed page, the written word, and would make it alive in our individual hearts in such a way that when we leave the service, we will feel as if you were speaking just to us. May you make the Scripture so personal to us tonight that it will impact the way we think, the way we behave tomorrow, that it will begin to shape the rest of our lives. May you be that real to us in the pages of your Word tonight. I ask you for Holy Ghost conviction, something that I can't produce. I can't do that for anyone in this room. Only you can. And I ask you for it tonight, the gift of spiritual conviction. Deal with us personally in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Verse 1, "The Song of Songs, which is Solomon's. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for thy love is better than wine. Because of the savor of thy good ointments, thy name is as ointment poured forth. Therefore do the virgins love thee. Draw me, we will run after thee. The king hath brought me into his chambers. We will be glad and rejoice in thee. We will remember thy love more than wine. The upright love thee." Now, when you read those words, maybe like me, you feel almost embarrassed, as if you're reading someone's private love letter, right? I mean, there's an intimacy about the Song of Solomon that makes us blush at times, especially when we read it in a public setting. And that's intentional. It is, in fact, an intimate document. It is, however, a great deal more than just a love letter from a man to a woman, a human being from man to woman. There's a great deal more to the Song of Solomon than that. I tell you this evening without any hesitation that I believe the real purpose of the Song of Solomon is to give us a glimpse into the deeply intimate relationship that the Lord Jesus wants to have with His bride, the bride of Christ, the church of the living God. I don't believe God put the book of the Song of Solomon in the Bible just to provide some risque material to be used in couples counseling and marriage seminars. I believe there's a spiritual theme in the Song of Solomon that is desperately needed in the day in which we're living. In fact, I know that so because in Ephesians chapter 5, the Bible says that the husband-wife relationship is really intended of God to be a picture of the relationship of the Lord Jesus and His church. So we have before us a passage of Scripture that on one level can be understood as a love letter, man to woman, husband to wife, but there's a great deal more to it than that. And so I want to think of it like that tonight. I want you to read these words with me and listen to the reading of this passage from the standpoint that Christ is in this passage and the Lord Jesus is. In fact, you do know, right? You can't read any passage in the Bible from Genesis to Revelation that Jesus is not the heart of it. Christ is the theme of the Bible. Don't ever make the mistake of thinking Jesus is confined to Matthew to Revelation. Every page, every paragraph in the Word of God has something to say about the Lord Jesus and how He longs to relate to us. You can find specific illustrations of that throughout the Bible. The Bible calls Jesus our Passover lamb. That lamb sacrificed back in Exodus 12, that was a picture of Jesus. The Bible says that when they raised that bronze serpent up on a pole to bring deliverance from the poisonous snakes that were killing the people, the Bible says that bronze serpent on a pole, that was Jesus, really. The Bible says when Moses smote the rock and water came out, the Bible says that rock, that was really Jesus. The whole Old Testament is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't read a page or a paragraph in God's book without finding Christ revealed one way or another. And so our text is one of those kinds of passages. I'll tell you tonight as I'm getting into verse 4, that's what I'm preaching on, the first half of verse 4 tonight. The longer I preach, the shorter my text gets, because the richer the Word of God gets to me. Words in the Word of God are so important, and so I want us to spend a few moments around the words in this great text, and I'll tell you as I begin to draw your attention to it that in verse 4 we have embodied the heart of what it means to have revival in your life. This is a revival text, really. Spiritual awakening, the Spirit-filled life, the Christ life, the abundant life of Jesus. All of these terms and phrases are just different ways of expressing the same essential idea. And that idea is the Lord longs to draw us into a deep intimacy with Him that is so fulfilling and satisfying that we can say, we remember your love better than wine. He's better to me than wine. I want you to think about this passage tonight for just a moment. Three things I'll show you in the first half of verse 4. And I'll comment on them as they relate to our individual spirituality and particularly the matter of personal revival. First of all, in verse 4, I find what I'll call a conscious dependency. A conscious dependency. You see the first two words of verse 4? Draw me. Draw me. Beloved, this is one of the greatest confessions of dependence upon the grace of God that I've ever seen in the Bible. The concept, the idea, the awareness that I cannot on my own even make spiritual progress unless God is drawing me unto Himself. The idea that I have nothing on my own that I can rely upon. I have no ability, no power, even no willpower that I can trust on my own. This is a confession of death to self-sufficiency and self-reliance. This is the essence of what it means to be aware of the fact that I can't do anything spiritually unless God is first involved in me, drawing me unto Himself. If I'm going to make any advance tonight toward revival, If I'm a Christian who needs, well, for that matter, if I'm an unsaved person who needs to be born again, but then as a Christian, if I've backslidden on God and gotten my eyes off of the Lord, if I'm ever going to have revival, it will require the Lord making me aware of the fact and enabling me to do something about it. Draw me. That's what the psalmist was talking about in Psalm 85. In these famous verses, you'll recognize a part of this text. I'm going to quote it to you. Psalm 85, verse 6 is the famous verse. Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? That's how we know we need revival. We're not rejoicing in the Lord. We're rejoicing in who wins a football game or rejoicing in what happens in the stock market. We rejoice in other stuff, but we're not rejoicing in the Lord. That's how we know we need revival. I'm not joyful in the Lord anymore, singing about being saved by the blood of Jesus and washed in the blood of Christ and the grace of God that caused me to. Those things don't kick my bucket over. I've got to have something else to get me happy. That's how I know I need revival, you see. So that famous verse, wilt thou not revive us again? But you know what preceded that verse? Psalm 85 verse 4 says, turn us, O God of our salvation, and cause thine anger toward us to cease. Turn us. What the psalmist was saying is we don't even have enough sense to know we ought to turn unless God gets involved and begins to convict us of it. If you don't initiate things, the psalmist said, we'll never have revival. Draw me. In other words, what this says to me, to my heart tonight, is this. I need God even to know how much I need God. I have to be drawn to Him even to know that I ought to be moving toward Him. One of the great, I suppose, depressions that come with ministry. I'll say that word. I'll use the word depression. It ought not depress us. It ought to just keep us humble and on our face before God. But one of the great, I suppose, difficulties of preaching is the realization I'm helpless to do anything about anybody in this building. I can't make anybody want God. I can't make anybody hunger and thirst after right. Nothing in the world that anybody can do to cause you. For that matter, I can't even make myself want the Lord. The truth is, God has to begin to draw me, or I'm never going anywhere spiritually. The word translated draw in this passage comes from a Hebrew word that is very forceful, very strong. It means to drag something, to pull something. And it is a word that by its own definition it expresses the idea of force being exerted. In other words, here is an inert object. Here is something that has no power of mobilization on its own, and if it ever moves, something has to pull it. That's what the writer of this verse is saying. The heart cry is, oh God, here I am like a lump of stone. I can't move an inch unless you pull me and empower me to do so. Could you follow that? Listen. The word of the text, draw me, implies that if I ever get moving toward the Lord, it'll be because the Lord has magnetically drawn me unto Himself. That's what Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6 is about when it says, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. John 15, Jesus said, if you don't abide in me and let my word abide in you, you're not going to be worth anything, because without me, you can do nothing. It is this consciousness of our dependence on the Lord that springs me into this passage. In fact, it's what hooked me initially as I was reading the word, the Song of Solomon in my quiet time. And those two words grabbed me. And I thought, oh, that ought to be my heart. My heart ought to resonate with this desire. Oh, God, draw me up into yourself. Pull me up into your arms. You remember what Jesus said in the book of Matthew chapter 23? He said, how often would I have gathered thy children together as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings. Now, let me back up from this just a moment and make this statement. If you have anything in you tonight that resonates with this, anything in your heart that says, that's exactly my desire, I want the Lord to draw me nearer to Himself, may I tell you that if there is in you something that says, draw me, then that is indicative of the fact that the Lord is already drawing you. Because if He wasn't already drawing you, it would never occur to you that you ought to be drawn. The very fact that it crosses your mind that you want to be nearer to the Lord than you now are, that in itself is an indication holy God is doing a work of grace in your life. Jesus said in John 6 and verse 44, no man can come unto me except the Father which sent me draw him. You know there's not ever been, not one human being in the history of our race has ever woke up one morning and said of his own volition, I'm just going to come to Jesus today. I'm just going to get close to the Lord. I'm going to get saved. Or those who are already saved wake up one morning and say, you know what, I'm just going to have revival. I'm tired of being away from the Lord. I'm going to get close to the Lord. Any person who's ever said to himself, I want to get close to Jesus, it's because the Father first drew him to Christ. If it hadn't been for that drawing work of the Lord, none of us would have made any movement, any motion toward Christ at all. You see, beloved, what this reminds me of tonight is this. God is always previous. Any spiritual inclination, any spiritual longing that I may feel or express toward Him, He was always there first, drawing me unto Himself. Whatever hunger and thirst I may have tonight for spiritual things, and I don't know where you are with the Lord, you in your own life, but I'll tell you what's happening in my life and in my wife and in our family. In the last month, 2 months, the Lord has been, I'm telling you, creating in us such a desperation for Him. I have not known how cold and far I'd gotten from the Lord until these last weeks. God has been compelling me, drawing me toward Him with a desperate appetite. And I'll tell you, any thirst that I have for God tonight, any hunger to draw near to Him, He was there first. It's not me initiating anything. It's the Lord in grace coming after me, dealing with my heart, making me aware that He Himself is my supply. In Acts chapter 17, the Bible says, God is not worshipped with men's hands as though He needed anything, seeing that He giveth to all life and breath and all things. You see, folk, God is never the taker and you are never the giver. He's always the giver and you're always the recipient of His grace. Philippians chapter 2 says this, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Sounds like it's all up to you, doesn't it? Get after it. Get busy. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But the next verse says, the rest of the sentence says, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. You would never want to do the will of God if God wasn't at work in you first. So Christ is the initiator, and I am the responder. What was it you said, Brother Dwight, early this week? The question was asked from the pulpit, why do you love Jesus? The Bible says we love Him because He first loved us. And my friend, you can inscribe this over every spiritual area of your life. He first. If I want Him, He first wanted me. If I cry out to Him, He first knocked on my door and sought to get my attention. That's why Revelation chapter 3 says this to the Laodicean church, as many, Jesus said, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Who's doing the knocking? He's doing the knocking on our door, seeking to disturb us enough that we'll begin to turn our hearts to Him in a fresh way. The Lord Jesus pronounced a blessing. Do you remember this? He pronounced a blessing on those who are poor in spirit. Blessed, He said, are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Being poor in spirit is exactly what's reflected in this passage of Scripture. It means I am aware that I am personally, spiritually bankrupt, and I have no resource and no recourse but the grace of God. But thank the Lord tonight, I need no other resource. He is enough and more than enough. Can you imagine any clearer way to express yourself as poor in spirit than the cry of this text, draw me? The New American Standard Bible renders it like this, draw me after you. It speaks of the desire of the beloved to be bodily taken up by her lover and carried away with him to wherever he desires. There is a conscious dependency in this verse of Scripture. I on my own can do nothing. I must have the Lord operative in my life. Draw me. Second part of the text, I'll call this a confessed determination. Draw me. We will run after thee. We will run. There's a fierceness to this verse, isn't there? There's a yearning in the heart of the lover for her beloved, the betrothed for her husband, There's a fierce yearning in the heart of this one for her Lord. Nothing cold or calculating about this, is there? This is not cool, calm, dispassionate religion. This is a person full of flaming desire for a deeper experience with Christ. Apathy's the great enemy tonight. It's what's killed American Christianity. Apathetic religion. Lukewarm complacency. Ho-hum, big deal church. Comfort zone, non-assertive religion that just drifts down in lazy indifference to the lowest common denominator. That's the essence of what it means to be backslidden tonight. Who cares? Big deal. No passion. No determination. One of my favorite preachers, as I told you earlier this week, is a man by the name of A.W. Tozer. A.W. Tozer said this, one of my favorite quotes from him, "Man is made of dust, and dust tends to settle." And that's our awful tendency, to settle down for less than what God said we could have in Christ. To content ourselves with the husk that the swine do eat, when our Heavenly Father has a table of plenty spread, a banquet spread for His children with food enough and to spare. It's ironic tonight that apathy is a sin that is born out of the fiery heart of hell, and yet apathy is marked by a lack of fire. Apathy is a chilly willingness to settle for spiritual mediocrity. Literally, the word apathy means no passion. A lack of intense emotion, either positive or negative emotion. No negative emotion, no brokenness over sin, no positive emotion, no real joy and celebration in the Lord Jesus. Just a sort of numbness of soul. In contrast to that apathetic spirit, that passionless religion, you have in our text the expression of a fiercely passionate desire to go on with God. If the Lord will just draw me, I will run after Him, is the statement. I will run. It doesn't say, if the Lord will draw me, I'll think about it and maybe saunter down the aisle. Or I'll sashay. Or I'll stroll along, you know. No, there's nothing casual about this. Nothing ambivalent. There's no uncertainty, no hesitancy, no lack of clarity and commitment. If the Lord starts to draw me, my response is I'm going to run just as hard as I can after. There's a fierce determination. The psalmist put it like this in Psalm 63, verse 8, "My soul followeth hard after thee." You know the difference between the average church member and the child of God walking in revival is that hard following after the Lord. It's a fierce determination. I will run. It's a focused determination. He said, "I'll run after thee." The writer said, "If you draw me, we will run after thee." You see, it's not just running tonight. It's not just running. It's not just religious zeal or frantic activity or church calendars full of programs and activity. It's not just running. It's running after Him. That's what matters. Psalm 27, verse 8 says, "When thou saidest, seek ye my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, I will seek." The Lord initiates it. He says, "Seek my face." And my heart responds by saying, "I will seek your face." We are a generation of Christians who have worn ourselves out from running. Most churches are worn out from running. But too often, we're just running. We're not running after Him. We're just running. We're chasing, you know, the end of the rainbow. We're chasing recreation or amusement. We're chasing religious fads and fashions. We're trying so hard to keep up with whatever the trends are, the latest thing in the culture and even in the church culture, that we wear ourselves out. I pulled up behind a car in Oklahoma preaching a revival meeting, pulled up at a red light, and there was a vehicle in front of me, and the lady driving the SUV had on her rear window those white silhouette stickers. You know what I'm talking about. On one side, she had a boy's name, and under his name, she had the picture of a football and a baseball and a basketball. On the other side, she had a girl's name, and under the girl's name was pictured a ballerina, a dancer, and I think a volleyball, something like that. And I said through the windshield of my car, I said, "Lady, I don't know who you are, but I know one thing about you. You're as confused as a termite in a yo-yo. You can't have two children in five major sports with all the practices and all of the performances that that involves without meeting yourself coming and going. We're a running bunch, brother. There's no slowing down in American life in American church. We run like the dickens. But it's not running that gets the job done, it's running after Him. Have you ever noticed how trendy we are in the modern church world? I'm going to compliment you as a state of churches. One of the things I like about coming to Mississippi and preaching in churches like yours is that you seem to have had the sense, most of you, that I go places I go, you seem to have had the sense not to just follow every little trend and fad that comes down the religious pike. This is a religiously trendy age we live in. We're constantly redefining how to do church and reinventing the wheel and trying to jazz things up. I'll tell you, we've got to stop chasing trends and fads and start chasing Jesus. That's what we need some of. We need some people who just want Christ, and we want Him so bad that nothing and no one's going to get in the way. Something gets in the religious world, and the whole Christian industry gets behind it and markets it, and every church in the land starts to chase after it without ever stopping to evaluate the biblical soundness of it. I don't want to chase trends and fads and the way things are done. I don't want to be running after cutting edge and relevancy and all of that kind of nonsense. I want to run after nothing but the Lord Jesus Christ. To be nearer, my God, to Thee. A deeper emptying of self in order to have a greater filling of the Holy Ghost. In Luke chapter 10, the story is told of two sisters who had Jesus and the disciples in their home. Martha and Mary, remember them? Martha was in the kitchen running hard. Had a house full of men to feed. 13 grown men. And maybe more, but at least that many in the entourage of the Lord Jesus. And they didn't have microwaves in those days, you realize. They couldn't pop down to the Popeyes and pick something up. I mean, it's a big job. Something had to be done. Men had to be fed. And she's in the kitchen doing what we would consider to be a reasonable thing and an applauded thing. She's laboring hard. Her sister Mary, however, says, I'm going to make a priority out of sitting at Jesus' feet. And I'm going to hear what Jesus has to say. And Martha did what probably I would have done. I don't want to be hard on her. I probably would have done it. I felt like doing it on many occasions, saying, Lord, would you please tell that sorry, lazy bunch of Christians to get off their behind and do something? I'm about to kill myself trying to serve you. And they're just sitting around twiddling their. That's what Martha did. She came in and said, Lord, would you tell my sister to get in the kitchen and help me? I'm about to kill myself trying to get this meal ready. And here she is sitting in here just listening to you talk. When the rebuke came, it must have been quite a shock, huh? Because Jesus did not rebuke Mary for what she was doing. He rebuked Martha for what she was doing. He said, Martha, you got so many irons in the fire, but there's only one thing that matters, and that's spending time at my feet, hearing what I have to say. Only one thing that matters. Sometimes, my friend, sometimes running after our beloved, the Lord Jesus, our first love, sometimes running after our first love means stopping our frantic, helter-skelter running around and intentionally isolating ourselves in a place of secret communion with Jesus. Running after the Lord means I treasure my relationship and my fellowship with Him above everything else. It means the great priority in my daily life is time spent with Jesus. Time in His presence, with my heart yielded so that He can speak to me, with my heart unburdening its cares upon the One who said He would bear my burdens for me. He becomes the unchallenged priority in my life. He is the one person, the one thing that I refuse to push aside with other concerns. I'm running after Him. You say, preacher, I'm just busy. Don't you know there's not enough hour in the day? There aren't enough hours in the day. I understand that. I know what you mean. But I'm telling you, if we ever get serious about revival, something's going to snap in our head. It's going to make us say, Jesus is not taking second place to anything in my life anymore. I'm going to run after Him. Would you agree with me tonight? We need something more than religion. We just need some. If religion could get the job done, America would be in business, brother, because we have a bucket load of it. We need more. We need something better than better church programs. We're always inventing programs, especially in Baptist life. And Lifeway gets behind it and sells it. We buy it and market it and implement it and plug into it and all of those things. We need something better than that. That's not getting the job done. We need something more profound than more profound sermon points, more interesting songs or exciting melodies. We need something more. We've got to focus our desires beyond the trappings of this idolatrous monstrosity of cultural Christianity in America. We've got to focus our souls on Jesus Himself and make Him the great passion and make sitting at His feet to hear His word our greatest priority. Not just sitting at the feet of men to hear what they have to say about Jesus, but sitting at Jesus' feet to hear from Him personally. Draw me, we will run after thee. I'm not denying that God ordains ministries to teach and preach the word. I don't deny that. The Bible clearly teaches that. But I'm saying there's got to be something in me that moves me beyond simply outward religious activity and draws me into the very presence of Christ Himself in my own personal and private life. The fact is tonight, beloved, you can only go so far on secondhand spirituality. You can only go so far. Hand-me-down truth can only grow you to a certain point, and then you're left a babe in Christ living on milk that someone else heard from the Lord. If you're going to get past milk to meat, you're going to have to be able to get in the presence of Jesus for yourself. Everything that God ever does in the Christian's life is to move us to the place where our passions for Him are so profound and so keenly focused that nothing and no one will ever draw us away from Him. Philippians 3:10 says that I may know Him. That's all it's about, that I may know Him. When we leave the service tonight, we all go our separate ways. I'll go down the hill and go to the room and go to bed tonight, this Tuesday night, one more night of revival meeting, and I'll head home to my family. And as I go down there and lay down on the bed and try to go to sleep tonight, the only thing that's really going to matter is this. Is there in me a throb that says, oh, Jesus, I want to know You? If there's not, it doesn't make any difference what I do in this pulpit. Anybody can say words. Anybody can look a certain way in a public setting like this. But the real me is revealed if whether or not there's something in me that says, oh, God, draw me. And I'm telling you this, I'm going to run. I'm running after Thee. One of my favorite songs, Brother Dwight, is a song I've never heard sung in church. I have a weirdness about me that makes me out of step with a lot of people, but that's okay. I've decided everybody's weird, just most folk hide it better than I do. I read hymns. I read the text of hymns. I love hymns. The depth of them, the spiritual richness of them. And I found this hymn and wrote the words of it in the flyleaf of my Bible years ago. Never heard it sung. I've never to this day heard it sung in church. The title of the song, however, grabbed my heart. This is what it said. This is the title. My goal is God Himself. Now listen to this verse. Listen to this verse. My goal is God Himself. Not joy, nor peace, not even blessing, but Himself, my God. 'Tis His to lead me there, not mine, but His. At any cost, dear Lord, by any road. That's this verse written into a song. It's not quoted in the hymnal as the source of it, but that's exactly what this verse says. My goal is not religion. My goal is not the applause of men. My goal is not even my own joy and peace or blessing. My goal is nothing less than God. And I know that I'll never get there on my own. It's His to draw me there. But I'm saying this, I want it so bad, Lord, whatever it costs, please do it in my life. My goal is God Himself. Lastly this, I'm almost through. If you're taking medicine, it's only 5 after 8. And I'm not making fun of that. I take medicine myself. Draw me, we will run after Thee. The King hath brought me into His chambers. Well, amen. That's what it's all about. I call it a consummated desire. The consummation of the desire of this writer, the consummation is the King hath brought me into His chambers. May I tell you tonight, child of God, there is fresh bread and wine to be had in the communion of the Lord. There's a fresh experience. It's better than physical wine. It's better than any chemical high. Nothing this world has to offer can compare, because it leaves no hangover of regret. It leaves no bitter aftertaste of guilt. That's why the Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. There's a better alternative, my friend. This bar-hopping crowd, this modern religious age, these social drinkers, these bar-hopping Christians, I'm telling you, there's a lot better option than that. You don't have to go clubbing to have a good time if you just get full of the Holy Ghost. Better than wine, the writer said. We will be glad and rejoice in thee. We will remember thy love more than wine. The upright love thee. I want you to know this tonight, friend. There is an abundant life to be had. There is an overflowing life of victory in Jesus. If we run after Him, if we respond to His drawing, His gracious dealings in our heart, if we turn our hearts away from the vanity and the foolishness of this present world and focus on the glory and the beauty of the Lord Jesus Christ, I want you to know He said we can get in His chambers. The King will carry us into His chambers. Jesus said this in the New Testament. He said, if you thirst, if any man thirst, come unto me and drink, and out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. When I begin to prize Christ above all else, when I want Him more than everything else rolled up together, when I'm panting after Him like a deer panting after the water brooks, when He alone is the only hope for my heart and the only source of satisfaction that I have confidence in, well, according to Psalm 37 in verse 4, if we'll delight ourselves in the Lord, He will give us the desires of our heart. And of course, that means He's the desire of my heart. So He gives me Himself. Wouldn't it be wonderful tonight when we go our separate ways, when we start to fall asleep this evening, if we could honestly say, the King hath brought me into His chambers. Not just say, well, I went to another church service tonight, heard another sermon, sang a few songs, read another Christian chapter in a Christian book. Not just say that, but to be able to say, I've taken His yoke upon me and I'm learning of Him. He has drawn me into His embrace. I'm turning away from dead religion. I'm entering into the personal intimacy, a living, vibrant, invigorating fellowship with the very King of Kings. James 4 says, draw nigh to God and He'll draw nigh to you. Dear friends, is God drawing nigh to you? Can you sense Him tugging on your heart? In these days of revival meetings that we've been having, as I've preached to you from various scriptures on the need of the hour, the need to hunger and thirst after the Lord, the need to repent our way to revival, has the Spirit of God tugged on you, called you onward, upward, sought to draw your mind and your affections away from infatuation with this world, urged you into a deeper love affair with Himself? If not, if you can honestly say, no, the Lord hasn't said a thing to me, hadn't dealt with, then it is appropriate for you to do what this text says. Say to Him, draw me. Draw me, Lord. If so, if you say He's drawing me, I've sensed it. I know that He's calling me to a deeper level of spirituality than I've experienced. If you can feel Him drawing, then start running. Not after religion, God help us. Not after emotional experiences, but after Him. Run after Him. He loves you. He wants to take you into His chambers. He wants to carry you into the place of deepest intimacy with Him. And when you get to that place with Him, you'll find yourself agreeing that His love is better than wine. I bet you know this old song. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in His arms. In the arms of my dear Savior, oh, there are 10,000 charms. His love is better than wine. Would you stand tonight as we pray? Father, the limitations of language frustrate me tonight. The limitations of the human tongue to try to speak these things. I must call to Thee, O God, to take the written word and make it a living reality in the lives of Your people. And I do so now for Jesus' sake, not for ours primarily, although it would certainly be a blessing in our heart if we had it happen to us, but more than our own blessing, may Christ be honored and glorified tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer to him? Time after time, he has waited before, and now he is waiting again to see if you're willing to open the door. Oh, how he wants to come in. If you'll take one step toward the Savior, my friend, you'll find his arms open wide. Receive him and all of your darkness will end within. Time after time, he has waited before, and now he's waiting again to see if you're willing to open the door.